More now on our top story this morning, and tributes are rolling in for iconic Aussie comedian Barry Humphries.
The 89-year-old and his alter ego, Dame Edna Everage, have been leaving audiences right around the world rolling in the aisles for decades.
That is all very true, and joining us now is one of Barry's very good friends and neighbour, author and dinner party guest on numerous occasions with the great Barry, Kathy Lette. Kathy, you've known Barry since you were a wee thing, at the age of 19, I think. How are you remembering him today? What a loss, huh?
Well, it's been a sad day. We've been worried for the last week or so, you know, so trying to prepare ourselves. But, you know, he's such a showman. I just keep thinking, surely there's going to be an encore. I can't believe that I'm not going to see him. You know, we're all in pieces. We're heartbroken. It's a great loss for Australia because he was our most famous export, I would say. And a great loss for the world because he's been taking our cultural temperature with a satirical thermometer for what, nearly 70 years?
Incredible.
And he's so expert at picking pomposity with his that sharp, lethal wit of his that we've needed him to keep us sane and to keep us laughing at life's adversities. So it's just a terrible loss. I don't know how we'll replace him. The greatest comedian since Charlie Chaplin, I would say. Well, Richard, you knew him well. You'd interviewed him many times.
Indeed.
And you had to be hospitalised from hilarity, didn't you, every time you spoke?
Well, he could be brutal, couldn't he? I mean, you used to feel sorry for people who arrived late to one of his shows or were sitting up in the first few rows because they were in for it.
Australia, we're famous for our deadly, venomous creatures. You know, we've got the box jellyfish and the funnel web spider and the tiger snake and the tiger shark and the Dame Edna Everage. So, yes, I want to be sitting in those front few rows and brought up on stage because that wit could be poisonous. Mm. But you know, Dame Edna had that ability to elevate and annihilate at the same time.
Mm.
And one of my favourite stories was when he was interviewing Michael Bolton. She was interviewing Michael Bolton and said, "Well, Michael, yes, what a success. You've had 9 hits this year alone." And Michael was puffing himself up, you know, egotistically. And then Dame Edna added, "On your website."
Ouch.
So, you know, she could, you know, praise you and slap you at the same time.
Exactly.
And, of course, then there was the amazing Solaire, her cultural attaché, who had that remarkable ability to point out the whole herds of elephants in every room. Mm. But Barry, their manager, was their antithesis.
Mm.
You know, when you got to know him, warm, witty, wise,
classy,
kind, generous.
Mm.
You know, you couldn't have a more loyal and loving friend. And as you mentioned, Richard, Barry and I have been friends since I was a teenager. And I first met him at the Melbourne Comedy Festival. And I went up to him and said, "Hi, I'm Kathy." I said, "I think you might have invented me." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "Well, you know, Dame Edna has a daughter called Val May who's married to Mervyn, and they live in a blonde brick veneer in suburbia. My mother's name is Val May. She's married to Mervyn, and they live in a blonde brick veneer in the Shire." I said, "Am I a figment of your imagination?"
You
so we became very firm friends right from that moment. And then, of course, when I moved to London 30 years ago, as you mentioned, Richard, I moved into Barry's area. We used to call this area Vegemite Valley. And Barry was my neighbour. And his house literally backs onto mine. So every time he got home from overseas, he'd send me an email saying something like, "Kathy, dear, I'm poised at your rear entrance," or something wickedly to say like that.
We
were going to get a flying fox between our gardens so we could just zoom across and see each other whenever we felt like it. So, yeah, and I mean, a dinner party, as you said, Richard, and I'm sure you've been to many parties with him, a dinner party with Barry was the Wimbledon of wit, with one-liners just bantered back and forth. He was the Navratilova of the backhanded compliment. I always say he had what I call a black belt in tongue foo.
Mm.
You know, and what an incredible gift.
And it was love all love, wasn't it? Yeah.
Very well said. Exactly, that's right, yeah.
Kathy, do you have any special memories of maybe the last time you saw Barry?
Yes, well, I saw him in hospital in Sydney, of course, And, well, first of all, we had an amazing New Year's Eve together, which would become a tradition where we'd go to his harbourside apartment and his beautiful, talented wife, Lizzie, would be cooking up a storm and the champagne would be popping and as popping as much as the fireworks. And he was so looking forward to this year. He was going to do another comeback tour, do his one-man show in London. And so, you know, we were so upset when his hip operation, there were complications and then things spiraled down very quickly. But when I went to see him in hospital, he was still cracking jokes. And the one thing he wanted to do was make sure the nurses were laughing and that his visitors were felt at ease. So the last time I saw him, we were making jokes. He was making jokes about obituaries and what words could and couldn't be used. He said he didn't want anyone to call him delightful or nice or bubbly, which meant drunk. And then he was making jokes about the Grim Reaper, you know, walking down the corridor with his scythe. And he would joke with the nurses about how many people the Grim Reaper had collected that day. And I was saying, well, yeah, if they'd been with you, they would have died laughing. But he was joking about the Grim Reaper, what terrible clothes he had and how, you know, it was the original hoodie. I mean, he just could not help but be funny. It was his default position. So there was an hysteric of self-indulgence about him. He was just a beautiful human being. And I don't know how I'm going to survive without him, because, of course, he's been my anchor in London as well. And we'd often get together and have a giggle and a laugh and cackle like kookaburras about British pomposity, you know, and blow raspberries at the upper class. And, you know, we had that delicious camaraderie that Aussies have, you know, when you're in London or living in some other city. So I am absolutely bereft without him, and I've lost my anchor.
Well, Kathy, speaking of the impact he had globally, not just a national treasure but an international treasure, what sort of impact did he have globally?
Well, the icing on the fame pie came for Barry when he was in the Ally McBeal show. And on the back of that, he did two big Broadway shows in London, for which he won two Tony Awards, which was the ultimate. I mean, he was friends with Joan Rivers, he was friends with Sondheim, he was friends with all the greats. So, you know, his humour just resonated around the world because it was so true. It was witty, but it was gritty. There was always an element of authenticity and piercing perspicacity behind his observations on life and people, and especially celebrities. And also, he was so prescient. I remember when Dame Edna was doing her show, she interviewed a very lowly MP, Boris Johnson, who was sort of nothing at the time, and predicted that Boris would be Prime Minister of Britain. And then there's another famous clip where he was interviewing this hardly known American businessman called Trump and predicted that he would be President of the United States. I mean, that's pretty astounding, isn't it? And I mean, as much as we're pining and craving Barry's company and pining for him, he has left us an incredible legacy of laughter. So, I mean, Dame Edna and Solaire's and Sandy Stone will live on in our consciousness because of all these wonderful clips. So,
characters, Kathy, you know, one of the things I love from having the pleasure of working with him, when he was in character, it was total commitment, wasn't it? There was, you know, you'd never talk to Barry when he was dressed as Edna. You would talk to Edna. I mean, it was just full-on commitment, wasn't it?
Total full-on commitment. And you know, he was a complicated man in that he had all these other personas. And he told me once that, you know, when Dame Edna was on stage, he often felt like he was Dame Edna's manager in the wings watching her, and she'd say something brilliant and he'd think, that's a really good line. He was a natural showman. I've never met anyone who was more at home on the stage than Barry Humphries. And he told me once when he was running around London and he was really busy and he had a hectic day, he was promoting his show and doing interviews and whatever, and when he got to the Palladium, which seats about 2,000 people, he walked on stage, looked out at that vast auditorium and said, alone at last.
Yeah.
Because that made him so happy. And Richard, the time he found most difficult was during the pandemic lockdowns. because, I mean, for me as a writer, it was sort of situation normal. I could just keep doing what I do. But for Barry, who lived for the audience and for the applause, it was incredibly hard. So every Thursday night in London, we had Clap for Carers, where we'd all emerge out of our houses and we'd clap the frontline workers for keeping us safe. And Barry told me that, you know, he would go to his top balcony where no one could see him. He'd come out and he would applaud the frontline workers, but then he'd actually take a moment and pretend the applause was for him. He'd take a bow and he'd wave his hand like that just because he needed that sustenance of applause. So, yeah, a natural showman.
Well, the applause continues here, there and right around the world, I would suggest. What a loss. Lovely anecdotes, and thank you for your time, Kathy. We're sorry for your loss.
Well, all we can say is goodbye, possums.
There you go. Thank you. See you, Kathy.
Bye-bye. What a great chat. Thanks, Kathy.